sisters in Accra. As DC introduced me, my name is Edwin Kwikwondo-Bafo. I am the vice chair of the Black Starline Credit Union, and he's spoken a little bit about it. We are a little bit behind time. I'm supposed to speak about another civil society organization that I work for, volunteer for, which is Food Sovereignty Ghana. So I want to remind you that we have an information desk where the manager, Kevi Asare, if you can put up your hands at the back there. That's all our people, the Black Star Line Cooperative Credit Union. They can provide you with a little bit more information, tell you a little bit about our savings products, our attractive rates, and a little bit more about the membership, how DC said we are owned by ourselves. So you can get facilities from us where you would be have to provide so much more collateral and different kinds of things to build our community. So each of you, if you're seriously thinking about coming back to Ghana, you shouldn't be thinking of keeping the bulk of your money in the chases and the big banks. You have to put your money where your mouth is. You have to start building our own credit unions, because our credit unions then led to us, and then we build what we want to build. And so I encourage each and every one of you, if you're thinking of moving back to Ghana, open an account. You can start to save before you come back, because you know, a penny each day for the rainy day, even if you don't plan to come back 2, 3, 4, 10 years, but start saving now, buy the piece of land, and the land is always appreciating, and so on and so forth. But I'm here also to talk to you about Food Sovereignty Ghana, the civil society organization that I volunteer for. I'm the communications director. And in Ghana, we were registered in 2013, so this is our fifth year in existence. As you know, the neo-colonial agenda to control the resources of Africa has never relented. Since the efforts of our founding fathers, of Osagyefo, Dr. Kwame Nkrumah, we've not seen the sort of development that this nation, and indeed this continent, has deserved. And there have been so many avenues that the neo-colonial agenda has tried to hold a grasp on African people. And the latest one is on our food. And the civil society organization I volunteer for, Food Sovereignty Ghana, has been at the forefront of fighting against the imposition of GMOs into our food and agriculture system. We've taken the government to court because we feel that the government and policymakers are not thinking long term about the dangers of genetically modified organisms. You all live in the US, where the US first introduced GMOs into the world. But it's ironic that in the US there's still no labeling of GMOs, because multinational lobbies have found a way to safeguard that territory, keeping it a no-go area so that there's no traceability to all the cardiovascular disease and all the problems that you have with health, all the cancer. There's this buffer zone, and without the labeling issue, there's no traceability to say that this family has consumed this kind of food for 10 years and look at how they look, look at how they feel. The same sort of agenda is starting to happen in Ghana. We have policymakers who, for no other reason, I think, have definitely been compromised. If you look at Ghana, the issues that affect agriculture in Ghana and in Africa for the most part are four: access to credit for farmers, a lack of roads from the farm to the market, a lack of irrigation technology, so we still rely on rainfall-fed agriculture, and a lack of post-harvest infrastructure, which would minimize post-harvest loss. So these four issues that affect agriculture are not going to be alleviated with the introduction of GMOs. And I repeat it, none of the issues that affect agriculture seriously in this country and on this continent are going to be helped by the introduction of GMOs. And so, why am I talking to you about GMOs? Because you're coming from a place where the government has forced its way to have GMO available for consumers. We're trying to make sure that, first of all, we demand a mandatory labeling regime in Ghana. And already the policymakers are trying to run away from that. And recently, as of last week, one of the professors from one of the research organizations says that our call for a mandatory labeling regime is uncalled for, and that GMOs don't need to be labeled. But on the one hand, you say they're safe to eat and they don't cause cancer. On the other hand, you don't want them to be labeled. But we have to play a role, because when you come here, you need to interact with a lot of our brothers and sisters. Your experience abroad is very valuable to our brothers and sisters to help them understand what it is exactly we're fighting for, what it is we're positioning ourselves for. When we say don't accept GMO, why? Is it just food sovereignty, Ghana? It's good to hear from our brothers and sisters. And when you interact with them in your 10 days, 7 days here, please let them know what you know about our food and why it's important to safeguard our food. We're losing different local varieties of food because genetically modified engineering brings uniformity to food. I looked at a picture of local maize from Mexico. It looks like something out of a fairy tale. It's got different colors. On the crop, you have red, green, blue, yellow, and orange, like M&Ms. And this is a maize crop. But this is what original maize used to look like. It didn't look all yellow and all white. So we're losing the varieties. And the impact of chemicals on the land is unsustainable. If you go to farms, you see the farmers tell you they don't see mushrooms anymore. They don't see snails walking around. When I came back home in 2002, you find earthworms. Even as of 5 years ago, you find earthworms after a rain like this afternoon. I don't think anybody has seen an earthworm this afternoon after the rains. So all this is telling us that this chemical form of agriculture that we're following, this agenda that is being pushed down our throats, is unsustainable. It will kill the land, it will kill the forest, and it will kill us eventually. Unfortunately, we have compromised individuals in policy, in parliament, in all the way to the top. Media people who don't see the long-term advantage of positioning Ghana to provide organic food for the growing demand for organic food all around the world. You know how much organic food costs where you come from. People pay a premium to eat organic food. So from a strategic point of view, it would be visionary for Ghana to position itself as an organic haven. And if you picked up a bottle of orange juice in Holland or in the US or Sweden from Ghana, you would guarantee that this is an organic juice, and somebody would buy that instead of buying a GMO pineapple juice coming all the way from Ghana, when you could buy an organic one from Costa Rica or Belize or something like that. So we have a role in protecting our heritage. Our food is so important to African people. If it wasn't for food, some of you would be sitting here today, I'm sure. And those of you thinking about food are waiting for me to get off the mic. So, in order to not take up too much time, I want you to visit www.foodsovereignty.ghana.org. Foodsovereignty.ghana.org. Ghana, G-H-A-N-A. And we have a Facebook page, we have a website. And we try to put up-to-date information as supplied through our network of friends and scientists around the world. Who give us the real scoop, the independent research that tells you that Monsanto's glyphosate is carcinogenic, that tells you that now a lot of these commercial brands have glyphosate residues in Cheerios and Weetabix and all these big brands. So we need to encourage yourselves, grow your own food, and if you're going to come back home, have a vision to grow your own food, get a piece of land, and keep local varieties. So without further ado, please visit our table for the Black Star Line Corporate Credit Union, and visit our website, foodsovereignty.ghana.org. And let our brothers and sisters know the importance of keeping our nation and its natural endowment with its integrity. Thank you very much.
Okay, we're close toward the end of this session, and then we'll open up a question and answer. We have just two more speakers, about 10 minutes, we should close out. The last one.